Hello, good afternoon. Now that the epic background music is starting to fade out, I was hoping we could get started for our session. I wanted to start with some minor details, which is the Red Lanyard. If there's any people with Red Lanyards in the audience, then they can ask questions from the rear of the room if they would like, and that way you remain out of the view of the camera. Then the second thing, the closing ceremonies are also going to be in here, and if there are any people who haven't yet picked up a bottle of water or any other type of swag, you're very welcome to help yourself to that. On those notes, good afternoon. Thank you for joining this session, day three. Everybody's probably feeling it, and that's why it's great that you're here. My name is Karen Katt. I'm a PhD student at the Oxford Internet Institute, and I work really closely with Article 19, the Human Rights NGO. And we're here today to talk about government hacking. Now, we see a development where increasingly governments across the world are using hacking. And this is becoming more important to talk about as the internet is increasingly everywhere. It's in our devices, in some cases it's in our bodies. So these kind of movements have real impact. And we have a great panel today to discuss these different issues. Starting with Scarlett Kim from Privacy International, then Ton Sietma from Bits of Freedom, Amy Stefanovic from Access Now, and Jean-Yves Aert from Microsoft. Now, I would like to give you the floor first, if you would like to start. The idea is that everybody gives a 7 to 8 minute background talk, discuss some of the developments they see, introduce some of the worries they have, and possibly also some of the possibilities for moving forward.
Thank you. I want to thank Ton for organizing this panel and also to Access Now for hosting us today. What I'm going to do is I'm going to begin by speaking briefly about Privacy International's international human rights approach to surveillance. And then I want to highlight a bit of the history of our work on hacking, focusing on litigation and legislative advocacy in the UK. And I want to use that to tease out a few facets of what an international human rights approach to government hacking looks like. I have a few slides, actually, so I'm going to see if this... Great, thank you. So Privacy International focuses on human rights issues arising at the intersection of privacy and technology. That means that our work is grounded in the international human rights framework. In the surveillance context, that means that we scrutinize state surveillance through the lens of interference with rights established in international human rights law. That means naturally that our work focuses on privacy and freedom of expression issues, but we also consider the impact of surveillance on a range of other rights. So for example, where a state relies on a novel surveillance technique, such as hacking, to gather evidence and then fails to insufficiently disclose that evidence, that technique in relying on that evidence, that may impact the right to a fair trial. I want to mention at the outset a major caveat to the international human rights or broadly legal approach. So at PI, our technologists like to say that tech resides above, beside, and below the law. And as a lawyer, I translate this to mean that technology can be legally disruptive. And that means that disruption can take many forms. It can mean that it drives institutional change, so how courts or law enforcement makes decisions. It can make it harder to enforce existing law, or it can require existing law to substantively change. The disruptive quality of technology means that we have to constantly assess the law against new technological developments, and that requires, first of all, factual humility, and it means understanding that understanding tech requires expertise outside of the law, and sometimes it requires legal creativity, so considering how the theoretical basis of a law or its application should change. So in the hacking context, we might ask how we conceptualize an interference that differs very dramatically from traditional communication surveillance, and how we might correspondingly design adequate safeguards. So one of PI's first major forays into hacking began with the Snowden disclosures, which revealed that the NSA and GCHQ, the British Signals Intelligence Agency, were conducting sweeping hacking operations domestically and abroad. And on the back of those revelations, in May 2014, we brought a complaint in UK court where we argued that GCHQ hacking violates Articles 8 and 10 of the European Convention on Human Rights. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about the substance of those claims. In February 2016, the court rejected our complaint and we're pursuing two separate challenges. And for timing reasons, I'm going to gloss over the procedural history, but I'm happy to discuss the details more with those of you who are interested. So the major theme I want to tease out right now from our litigation is something that's familiar to anyone who does surveillance work, and that's the secrecy that swirls around government hacking. And bringing government hacking out of the shadows was one of the major goals of our case. Article 8 of the European Convention on Human Rights, which protects the right to privacy, requires that interferences with privacy, i.e. hacking, be both in accordance with law and be necessary in a democratic society. These are bedrock international human rights principles that are reflected also in the necessary and proportionate principles. I'm going to discuss the necessary in a democratic society prong in just a second, but the in accordance with law prong requires hacking to have a clear basis in domestic law and be accessible and foreseeable, and we consider this the legal antidote to secrecy. Now, our challenge against secrecy was successful in a way. We alleged that GCHQ had no clear authority under British law to hack, and that led to legislative developments. So during the proceedings, the government claimed that it was relying on a broad power to interfere with property under the Intelligence Services Act, and then it released a code of practice, which is basically secondary legislation, where it fleshed out a framework governing hacking. And then subsequent to that, it introduced new framework surveillance legislation, which was recently passed, called the Investigatory Powers Act. The Act places the power to hack, what it calls equipment interference, on explicit statutory footing for the first time in the UK, and the inclusion of the hacking powers were a direct result of our litigation. Now, while the open regulation of hacking powers is preferable to governments wielding them in secret, the hacking powers as contained in the Investigatory Powers Act are a litany of human rights horrors. And I'm going to highlight a few key areas. So I previously mentioned that international human rights law requires interferences with privacy to be both in accordance with law and necessary in a democratic society. The necessary in a democratic society prong relies on the state to demonstrate compliance with a series of safeguards. And in recent surveillance law cases, the European Court of Human Rights has identified three key safeguards. These are also reflected in the necessary and proportionate principles. And those are individualized reasonable suspicion, prior independent authorization, and notification to targets. The IPA fails on all three, but for the sake of time, I'm just going to focus attention on the first one. So returning to our case very quickly, the government interpreted the power to interfere with property under the Intelligence Services Act to permit thematic warrants to hack, which basically can cover an entire class of unidentified persons, places, or property. In oral argument, we posited, and the government agreed with us, that it could seek a single warrant to hack all mobile phones in a single British city. The Investigatory Powers Act places these thematic warrants on explicit statutory footing. Under the so-called targeted hacking power, it permits thematic warrants. And so even though thematic warrants are described as targeted, they sever suspicion from a specific individual and therefore fail the individualized reasonable suspicion test. I want to return quickly to my earlier remarks about the disruptive quality of technology. So one of the most alarming aspects about hacking is that it disrupts the traditional human rights assessment of state interference. So traditionally, we typically balance the rights of the subject of surveillance against the state's need to conduct, for example, an investigation. But hacking brings new equities into play because it presents much broader security risks, which can affect many individuals, including innocent third parties. And so that traditional balancing that we do under the human rights approach needs to somehow take into account these new equities. So the issue of security raises the question of types of hacking techniques, and Tan asked if I might touch on the regulation of techniques, particularly the use of vulnerabilities. And he's going to elaborate on this a bit more in the Dutch context. But in the UK context, there's really no regulation to speak of. What I've thrown up on this slide is the only discussion of techniques contained in connection with the Investigatory Powers Act. It's contained in the draft code of practice. And as you can see, basically everything is fair game, any type of technique, any type of device. Okay, so in my last few minutes, I do want to touch on, from a security perspective, one of the most disturbing powers in the Investigatory Powers Act, which is an issue emerging across many other jurisdictions, and that's the power to compel companies to assist hacking. In the Act, there are two mechanisms for doing this. The first is that the hacking powers authorize government agencies to compel telecommunication providers to assist in effecting a warrant. And the definition of telecommunications providers is very, very broad. It basically includes any provider with UK customers, so it has a very broad extraterritorial reach. There's no judicial authorization required. The government can simply serve the warrant on a telecommunications provider, and the assistance will be conducted in secret, so providers are subject to a gag provision. The other mechanism is technical capability notices, which our former deputy director described as Apple v. FBI on steroids. They basically provide for an end run around an Apple v. FBI circumstance, because they require companies to bake in the capability to hack their customers, including by removing encryption. It's essentially permanent. The notices would only be reviewed once every 2 years, and they're incredibly invasive. So a company subject to such a notice would have to notify the government before it makes changes to existing services or develops or launches new products or services. And even though judicial authorization is required, it's still subject to a gag provision. I'm going to end here. I'm a little bit over my time, and I apologize. There are a lot of questions that remain regarding the international human rights approach to government hacking, and we're going to continue to explore them. I touched very briefly upon the warrant regime, but there are still a lot of critical questions about how to weave in the proper balancing of novel privacy and security concerns. And I, you know, didn't have time to touch on a myriad of other issues. So, for example, what should proper notification look like? How should it be affected, in particular to third parties such as manufacturers? And how you properly document government hacking operations? So what should a proper audit trail look like? And both of these issues require both technical and legal expertise. Finally, I want to end by noting that I've limited the discussion to the UK context, but we continue to explore these issues in other parts of the world. So in the US, we've been watching law enforcement hacking unfold, and we've intervened in several cases. We have partner organizations throughout Latin America, Africa, and Asia, and in more broader informal network in Europe. And we've worked with several partners to address emerging hacking developments in their jurisdictions. And moving forward, we want to continue identifying and studying other examples of government hacking in with the goal of producing a cohesive and coherent international human rights approach. And we're very eager to work with other organizations in this respect. Thank you.
Thank you, Scarlett. That was an excellent start to this discussion. I'm sure we can touch upon some of the issues that you raised when we open up the floor to questions from the audience. But first, I want to give the word to Amy from Access Now.
Hi, everybody. Thank you for being here. Thanks to Tone for organizing, my fellow speakers, and all of you for having made it so far through day three and actually showing up and mostly looking awake. There are a few tired people out there. I'm going to talk a little bit about the U.S. context of government hacking, because we actually have some information about what's been going on in the U.S., at least dating back to around 2001. In 2001, that's when when NBC actually published a news story that revealed the existence of a program called Magic Lantern, which was malware that the FBI was installing on target computers. Notably, this was not the first time the FBI had installed malware. That was many years prior in a case against a mafia boss in the US. However, this was the first program that we knew was effectuated through remote installation. So in the mafia case, they actually had manually installed a keylogger on this person's computer in order to get the password. But with Magic Lantern, it was remotely executing, which meant it could be installed from a distance. Even though this story starts in 2001, it then takes a huge leap. Because between 2002 and about 2013, the only information we have comes really thanks to Wired, who did a FOIA request that released a series of documents about FBI hacking operations, including a memo, a really fabulous memo, that discussed how the FBI could not overuse its hacking tools because they were going to become public, and then they were going to be subject to scrutiny, and God forbid they lose their hacking tools, so please don't overuse them. We learned about CPAV, which was Magic Lantern 2.0, essentially. It was their updated remote hacking tool. And then there were a small series of cases involving bomb threats in many instances, some drug dealings, extortion, I believe, in one case, where judges were being asked to approve hacking operations and were basically greenlighting these operations to go forward in very targeted instances. Enter 2013. And if anybody knows the US, you probably may be surprised to know that this was a case out of Texas where a magistrate judge decided that a FBI application to conduct hacking was too invasive, actually violated some procedural rules as well as the Constitution, and could not be approved. Magistrate Stephen Smith denied the application. He wrote a beautiful opinion, really, that said that there was this procedural hurdle, which I will talk about, that stood in the way of hacking operations, as well as hacking operations under the US Constitution were unconstitutional and could not move forward. Now, the FBI couldn't solve the constitutional issue, but they could look at the procedural issue. And so the procedural issue was this rule of criminal procedure, known as Rule 41, that basically required magistrate judges to only issue warrants in the jurisdiction where they are sitting. And because you cannot necessarily, or the FBI at least did not know where the computer was that they were searching, Magistrate Smith said that he could not enter this warrant because the computer was not located in his jurisdiction. So the FBI set out to amend that rule to say that there was an exception to it, basically for hacking operations. The amendment did a few things, but mostly it said when the FBI is conducting these hacking operations that this rule no longer applies. That rule went through a fairly obscure process in the United States. Basically, the Rules Committee reviewed it. Several groups, including Access Now, groups represented by some people in this room I know, showed up at a building in the middle of Washington, D.C., and we all testified and said that this rule was not acceptable, this rule change was not acceptable and couldn't move forward. They held another hearing, I believe, in Florida. That nobody was really able to go to. They eventually approved the rule, the committee did. The rule went to the Supreme Court of the United States, where the Supreme Court approved the rule, and then it went to Congress. And normally with law, Congress has to pass something for it to be implemented. With the rule changes, it actually is the exact reverse process. If Congress does nothing, the rule change goes into effect. And so we had argued, and many others had argued, that A, this process was backward, B, it was implementing a legislative change in the guise of a procedural change, and C, if that was going to happen, that it needed an affirmative act of Congress, and it shouldn't be this kind of don't act and this major change will occur. Notably, nothing is happening in the US Congress. It wasn't happening last year, it's not happening right now. So you will be unsurprised to know that they did not pass a law stopping this change from occurring. And so at the end of last year, it went into effect. We argued unpersuasively up until now that this is actually putting the cart before the horse, because in the US, there is no substantive authority for the FBI to be doing this in the first place. When the FBI started wiretapping, one of the things that they realized is that wiretapping is much more intrusive than other former search tools that they had been using. And so they passed a law called the Wiretapping Act that actually required increased evidentiary showings, increased requirements for a wiretapping warrant to be issued. If you know anything about hacking, you'll know that hacking is even more intrusive than wiretapping. It gets at all sorts of information, it can pack all sorts of people. A lot of times with malware, you don't know how it's going to act. I like to use the word malware, by the way, in response to government hacking, because in one of the government's briefs that they filed on hacking, they have said that when the FBI uses malware, it is not malware. So I like to think that the FBI has a not malware wand somewhere that they can wave over their malware to somehow make it not malware. So I use that word as much as possible. A little bit about what's happening in the background of all of this. The US had been involved in a case called Playpen. I don't know if anybody in the room knows the Playpen case. The three US people I know in the back of the room, I'll raise their hand. So the Playpen was a child pornography investigation
where they sought and received a warrant to place malware on a server and served it to everybody who was visiting this URL. That resulted in so many cases that are ongoing in the US. They got all of these people as IP addresses. They were able to determine that they were looking at child pornography and accessing this website. It is probably, and I believe, the first case that's going to occur where one single warrant is going to lead to a, or has led? No, is going to lead to a circuit split, meaning that multiple courts are considering these cases, and too many of the courts have come to very, very different opinions about whether or not this warrant was valid. And so courts are going to actually have to reconcile a circuit split stemming from a single warrant. They had also issued a similar operation about Tor mail, which actually shows the difference when you look at child pornography. Visiting a child pornography site may be seen as a crime in and of itself, but visiting Tor mail is definitely not. There's a lot of legitimate reasons to be visiting Tor mail. In fact, the overwhelming number of reasons to visit that website are probably legitimate, but in order to go after a few people, they were also installing malware there. Just to wrap up, because I'm over time and there's so many things to talk about, basically we're in this weird world in the US now where all of these cases are now procedurally possible, there is no substantive law, and the government is not even moving toward implementing a law like what we saw in the UK where they would substantively allow this to occur. We are also working, and we just submitted comments, Access Now submitted comments yesterday on a proposal out of Italy, where they are trying to implement a law that is actually, in the realm of government hacking, quite good, requires very, very heavy reporting requirements, requires that malware be removed from devices at the end of the operation, requires notice to people impacted by the operation. So we're trying to see if this is something, when governments are going to be using these tools, that can be replicated in other places. And to hint at something I'll be bringing up later in questions, as a result of all of this, last year Access Now released a report called A Human Rights Response to Government Hacking, where we tried to dig in and say, if there's going to be hacking that goes on, we do not think it should, but if it's going to happen, here are protections that we think need to be in place first of all. And so we're hoping that we can leverage this in the US and in other jurisdictions to push for these substantive provisions to be implemented.
Thank you very much for that great overview. So now that we've covered some of the UK developments and some of the US and even Italy, I invite Ton to speak a little bit more about the Dutch context.
Yes, thank you very much, Corinne, and thank you all for being here. My panelist, or am I? I'm also one of the panelists, obviously, and obviously the audience. It's great that you're here. And I would like to build, on what everybody else already said. And in particular, I want to discuss some stuff on user vulnerabilities, constraints in the amount of devices that can be hacked and the type of devices, and something on safeguards and how we can invent new safeguards. But for starters, first some backgrounds on the Netherlands. A lovely country, obviously. And there's recently been a vote on a bill which would give the Dutch law enforcement agency the ability to hack into devices remotely. Although the Dutch government says it's not hacking, but it's remotely accessing devices, but we call it hacking because, well, it is what it is. So I've been working on this bill for the last few years, and I would just like to use the opportunity to highlight some of the good parts of the bill and some of the bad parts of the bill in the hope that we can learn from it and improve it in other countries or improve it in the Netherlands in the future. So let's start with the use of vulnerabilities. In the Netherlands, there's been a lot of debate on whether the Dutch police, when hacking, would be able or should be able to use vulnerabilities. More particularly, the debate was about should you or should you not use unknown vulnerabilities, or also known as zero days, and these are obviously vulnerabilities which are not known to the manufacturer of the software. And in a sheer moment of total weirdliness, the Dutch government actually decided that it would do both using unknown vulnerabilities and not use unknown vulnerabilities. So, on the one hand, the Dutch government didn't want, they did want to improve the Dutch cybersecurity, or cybersecurity in general, and they don't want to be active on the market where a lot of people earn a lot of money by buying and selling these kind of vulnerabilities and basically making money out of the insecurity of the user or of the citizen. So the Dutch government and also the majority of parliament said, well, you're not allowed to buy unknown vulnerabilities. And we were like, all right, that's very good, very, very good. At the same time, the Dutch police is allowed to buy and use spyware or Trojans, which also use unknown vulnerabilities. So, while on the one hand, creating a general rule in which you're not allowed to buy these kind of unknown vulnerabilities, they're still allowed to, loophole that by using stuff from Hacking Team and other companies, which is kind of weird. And we're still a bit amazed on how that could happen. So our general advice would be, don't let that happen, create clear and strict rules on that. Secondly, something on the kind of device which can be hacked. So the Dutch definition of the device that can be hacked is like super, super broad. Basically, any type of electronic device falls into the definition. If you consider the growth of and the amount of IoT devices for now, but also in the future, it's almost unforeseeable which kind of devices can be hacked, but they all would fall under the definition. And that in itself might be problematic, but it's more problematic that a lot of these devices are increasingly entangled in and around our body and our personal life. So it's one thing to hack a laptop to gather some data, but it's another thing to hack, for example, a hearing aid or, as we used in the Dutch debate, a pacemaker. The consequence, obviously, is quite severe. Something goes wrong. If someone hacks a smartphone and the smartphone reboots or malfunctions, it's an inconvenience. It's you are sad, but you will live. But if a pacemaker malfunctions or a hacked car when driving, the risks are very severe, and not only for the hacked target, for the car, but also for the people on the highway, the other people. So the risks are very severe, and that's why we say there should be a list of a list or a classification or kind of types of devices which should be off limit for law enforcement hacking. Which we say, all right, we might understand that the gathered data is very helpful, but the risks if something goes wrong are too severe. This is something that we just cannot do. Lastly, something on safeguards. Obviously, there must be very strict legal safeguards. I mean, we've already talked about that, so I won't go into detail on that, but there are also other safeguards, such as the technical safeguards. And there's a problem in the Netherlands currently, because the law only prescribes and describes the legal safeguards, but not the technical safeguards. And that's tricky, because the technical safeguards are paramount for the protection of, the device, the protection of the target, the protection of other persons, but also make sure that the gathered evidence actually holds up in court. And it really amazed me that Parliament actually said, well, yeah, we get that, we kind of understand that, but still, just go on. We will start using this bill, we will start let the police hack without having really a proper regulation for the technical safeguards. It's like you're missing half of the puzzle, half of the safeguards, and I really don't get why Parliament actually voted for this. But, they did. But our lesson here is obviously that the technical safeguards should be put in place before the bill actually would become into place. So make sure that every safeguard is into place. Then, finally, something on ethics. So a lot of safeguards form constraints on hacking. And that's good. Legal constraints, technical constraints. But some constraints are neither technical or legal. But they do constrain the method in practice. And let me use an example. I recently spoke to a prosecutor, and he said, well, actually, I'm lying awake at night when I have to send people into a house to bug the house, because I fear for the safety of the police when they need to go in. You don't really know what to expect, and a lot of stuff can happen. And he's really worried about that. So he takes his own worries, and he takes the safety and the security of these police guys into account when deciding if a house is bugged or not. When hacking, obviously, it's done remote. There's, almost no risk for the police for the police guys or women who are hacking, apart from severe RSI, obviously. But they're practically good. But that means that, like, this type of original constraints are no longer in place. And that means that, yes, we can have pretty good legal safeguards, and they have been here for ages, and they will continue to exist. But we also need to maintain these other kind of constraints. So then is the question, what can we do about that? So here are just a few examples of which we might do about that. We could say, all right, there's a caps on the amount of devices that you can hack in a year. You could say, well, you're only allowed to hack 1,000 devices a year. I'm just freeballing here. But that's one opportunity or an option. Another one would be to increase the cost of hacking. Hacking is, well, quite cheap, but you could find ways to make hacking more expensive, not on the target side, but also, for example, say, all right, you are allowed to hack, but every time you hack into a device, you need to give 1,000 euros to the Dutch CERT, for example, to improve cybersecurity, because, you know, just to create a kind of balance and also make sure that hacking is not used as a tool of convenience, but only as a last standing. I don't know, hire some sort of ethics advisory board, which sit next to the prosecutor when deciding that someone should be hacked. Because it will be very easy to hack. It is very easy to hack. And the police will do it increasingly more and more and more because it's cheap, because you get so much information. I think it will replace all sorts of current investigation tools. It's really risky, and it's also very, I mean, the amount of information that you can get is increasingly so personal that I would say it's like, for me, I consider it the most invasive tool the police can have, actually. It's more invasive than a house search for me. So I would really encourage everybody to think about these kind of additional safeguards, not just now, but also in the future, because I really think we need that kind of stuff, besides, obviously, next to the technical and the legal safeguards. And that's that. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ton. I think this has given us a very good overview of what's going on in the US, the UK, the Dutch debate, and also a little bit the Italian debate. But I think it's also important to invite a non-civil society actor to talk about this, which is why I now give the floor to Sean Leaves.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for being here. I was listening to the whole discussion about hacking and really thinking that the way I see it is that hacking is really the tip of the iceberg, frankly. It is the tip of the iceberg, and it goes into something which is much broader than simply hacking. I think we need to look at it take a broader perspective, include hacking into it, but think a little bit about the rest of the iceberg and what we are going to do about it. For me, the way to start about it, the way to look at it is to look generally at all cyber attacks, in fact, that governments are launching against companies, against individuals, against civilians. Hacking falls into that category, but it's not the only one. I mean, the first one that always comes to mind is the one that took place in 2014 against Sony, when North Korean government was accused, alleged to have crippled Sony network just in advance of the release of this movie about a plot to assassinate the North Korean leader. That was followed by other cyber attacks, one that took place in 2015, in December 2015, where suddenly, following the use of cyber malware, according at least to US investigation, it turns out that the Ukrainian grid system was paralyzed and cutting electricity cutting hundreds of thousands of Ukrainian civilians from power supply. Go to one example of hacking, which took place in the spring of 2016, with Russia being accused of having hacked National Democratic Convention and getting and releasing through Wikipedia really thousands of emails of Hillary Clinton's and Bernie Sanders' campaigns, and as well as information about their funding. And you see, all those cyber attacks come one after the other, and it's something that we are seeing right now, witnessing right now, which is a major increase, broadening of the cyber attack. It's not simply hacking, but it's much broader than that, with attacks which are targeting civilians, which are targeting critical infrastructure, which is targeting our democratic process, and this is happening at the moment. You know, cyberspace is a new battlefield. That's exactly what is happening. It's a new battlefield. Just like the ground has been a battlefield, sea, air has been a battlefield. So that's where we are right now, with, however, two major differences compared to the traditional warfare. And for me, the two major differences are that civilians, private companies, private assets are the target of those attacks. It's no longer the armed forces, it's no longer the army which is the target of the attacks, but it's the civilians, it's their tools, it's their processes, number one. And second, it's that those private companies and those assets, those civilians are the means through which the attack is conducted. The means through which governments are conducted cyber attacks, it's through data centers, through servers, through computers, to smartphones that belong to all of us. So for me, these are really two critical differences in this new era where the cyberspace is becoming the new battlefield. Instead of having a battle between armed forces, between armies, you have a battle where the civilians and their assets are at the same time the target of the attack and the means through which governments conduct those attacks. So I think that in this context, there are really a number of actors which share a common interest. Of course, civilians have an interest not to be the victims of the attacks. Frankly, companies, which are the ICT companies, also have an interest in fighting those attacks. Why? Because, you know, the business of those companies, Microsoft is one of them, but it's not the only one, the business of those companies very much relies on the trust that civilians can place into the tools which they are using. So there is a commonality of interest there to look at those, again, in a broader context than simply hacking, but look at those cyber attacks and see what we can do about that. So that's something that we in the company have done, and as you may have heard, we released now a few weeks ago a proposal for what we call a Digital Geneva Convention, which is in fact the idea, we call it a Digital Geneva Convention not because Geneva should be the place where it's taking place, but because there are other Geneva Conventions, 1949, on the protection of civilians in times of war. And we believe that at this stage, with what's going on these days, with what's been going on over the past two or three years, we need also a convention for the protection of civilians in times of peace against those cyber attacks which are conducted by governments. And that Digital Geneva Convention that would protect civilians in times of peace, in our view, has really three main pillars. The first one is an agreement by governments, a binding commitments by governments to refrain from attacking civilians, to refrain from cyber attacks against critical infrastructure, whether it's a power grid, whether it's telephone systems, but a commitment not to attack civilians, not to attack critical infrastructure which are used by society, and a commitment not to attack the democratic process or the democratic tools, as again, it is alleged Russia did in the context of the US election. So that's number one. A convention by which all governments would commit to refrain from those attacks. In the way, at least I personally see it, it's a little bit akin to the Treaty on the Non-Proliferation of Nuclear Weapons. It's exactly the same idea, where you have really all governments coming, taking a step back, looking at what's going on and saying, okay, there are certain things that we are doing, we may be at war, and there are certain things that we will not do, even if we are at war. And the things that we will not do is that we will not target civilians, we will not target critical infrastructure, we will not target the democratic process or the democratic tools, number one. Now, once you have this kind of convention, you need to policy it. Otherwise, you know, it's easy to go away and say, nice commitments, thanks very much, but what do you do? So you need to have also an organization which is going to monitor the existence or inexistence of those attacks, and more importantly, which is going to be in a position to attribute any cyber attack to a specific government. We need to have that for that convention to be really working. And I think that this organization needs to be an organization in which private companies, just as the public sector, need to go together and fund it. To some extent, and I would say to a large extent, because expertise in this field is in the private sector more than in the public sector. So we need to have the two going together, build this international organization that will identify the authors of any cyber attack, that would target civilians, that would target critical infrastructure. The third piece, and it goes back to what I was saying at the beginning about this new battlefield, which has something very specific, the something specific being that it's private companies, it's private network, private assets, networks, the data centers, the servers, the computers, the smartphones that are really managed by companies that are being the target and the means through which the cyber attacks are being conducted these days. So the third element is an element with where those ICT companies come together and they say, we are not going to let governments use our network, we are not going to help them use our data centers, our servers to conduct those cyber attacks. And so we need also the private sector to come together and to send a clear signal that they will not provide help governments in conducting the cyber attacks, that they will also work together to assess and cooperate in fixing product vulnerabilities, which are usually the tools through which, or the doors through which cyber attacks are being conducted. So we believe that there are really these three pillars that need to come together in order to, if you want, make the environment in which we are all living these days, which is the cyberspace in which we're living, much safer. The three elements being this international convention, where governments make commitments, supported by an organization which is going to police this international convention, and also the companies, the ICT sector, coming together and saying, look, we are the means through which those cyber attacks are being conducted. We are not going to help. We are not going to help. We will not provide support, and we will work together in order to reduce as much as we can the scope for those cyber attacks. So that's the whole idea of the proposal that we have at the moment on the table.
Thank you very much for that background. So it's clear that this is very much a new frontier in which there are many open questions about the types of norms, the types of regulation, the types of laws, and the types of technology that we would need in place. So against that backdrop, I would like to open the floor to any questions from the audience. Are there any questions? Well, I'll give you some time to think of something to ask. And in the meantime, I would like the panel to reflect on some of the constraints that they would like to see going forward, legal, technical, normative, and or otherwise.
Sorry, I actually just, I think this will weave in some of the points about constraints that you'd like me to make. I want to address this idea about hacking being the tip of the iceberg, because I do agree with that. And I want to mention that at Privacy International, another strand of work that we're doing right now is looking at narratives around cybersecurity, especially as articulated by governments. And what we're seeing in a lot of places around the world is that governments are articulating cybersecurity as really an issue of defending against cybercrime and other attacks. And they're basically weaving in very, very aggressive, novel surveillance techniques like hacking in order to defend against those threats, when I think there is a much larger question about whether or not that undermines security more generally. And so this idea that I talked about the need to balance in the human rights context when you're figuring out whether or not to investigate someone, balancing the right of that individual against the need of the state, I think is writ much larger in the cybersecurity context, in which the state really has to ask itself and conduct a balancing assessment from a more holistic aspect as to whether or not some of the techniques that they're adopting are going to undermine privacy and security in general. The other thing I want to mention is that some of the alarming implications related to cyber attacks that were mentioned definitely apply when governments use hacking for what we would consider national security or law enforcement purposes, sort of in the realm where we might consider novel surveillance techniques to be adopted and maybe even accepted in certain circumstances. So I want to give the example of the playpen cases. We actually have intervened in one of the appeals in that case, and the argument that we wanted to make there is that when the FBI conducted a watering hole attack on, it was on a Tor hidden service, they were basically flying blind, and they ended up placing malware on, I think it was over 8,000 devices in over 120 countries and territories. Now, leaving aside the privacy and security implications, the foreign relations implications of that are really astounding. Even if you were to consider that a majority of those countries have some kind of cooperation agreement with the US when it comes to law enforcement, including for global crimes like child pornography and terrorism, there's probably a group of countries in there that wouldn't much like the idea that the US was basically infiltrating devices located within their territory. So this idea that cyber attacks have really enormous foreign relations consequences and can sort of rattle the relations between states and also the ability of states to protect their own citizens. I mean, this isn't just confined to situations where governments are, trying to intervene in democratic processes. I mean, those implications also flow from ordinary law enforcement using these techniques. I'm just going to leave. Oh, the one last thing I wanted to say, sorry, was you mentioned as part of the Digital Geneva Convention, you know, that companies shouldn't help governments conduct attacks. And then the question I have for that there again is bringing it back to the national security law enforcement context. Should governments compel companies to assist them conduct really, in some cases, very, very sweeping hacking operations, even in those circumstances? So we're not talking about offensive cyber attacks, but we're also talking about, for example, fundamentally undermining the security of a product in order to affect hacking capabilities down the line.
Would you like to respond?
Yeah. I'm not sure that I have the definitive response. In fact, I'm sure that I do not have the definitive response to the points that you are making. We need to find the right balance between true cyber attacks against other governments or civilians or infrastructure. And in my view, provision of data, that's how I would put it, the provision of data pursuant to law enforcement agencies, in particular pursuant to valid legal orders, they definitely are imperative requirements, situations in which I think companies, ICT companies, need to work together with law enforcement agencies and provide access to data which resides in their data centers, on their servers. We, like other ICT companies, do that when we are served with a valid legal warrant issued by a court. In some countries, sometimes it's the administrative executive power that has the authority to require this kind of information. And frankly, provided that we are served with is a valid legal order to provide data, which is in our data centers, pursuant to national security reasons, we will do that. I think that's also the responsibility of ICT companies to comply with those legal orders which we receive from courts, provided again these are valid legal orders. that in some cases we have challenged the orders because we believe that they're not valid. There is a very famous case which Microsoft has conducted against the Department of Justice up to the Court of Appeals, and we'll see whether it stops there. But there is a case that we have brought against our own Department of Justice that had required that we produce data residing in our data centers in Ireland, and we said the process which you are using to force us to provide the data, that process is not legal. There are certain legal constraints that apply to you, Department of Justice, law enforcement agencies, to get access to the data. You are bound to comply with that process. But once the rule of law is observed, once the rule of law is observed, we think that, you know, companies need to work with law enforcement agencies once they issue a valid legal warrant, a valid court warrant. Again, the thing is, you know, it's not easy to find the balance. I think that this, we are at a time where things are evolving. You know, it's not something which is, we're not yet set. That's why I was saying I'm sure I do not have the definite answer, because I think there's a process which is going to evolve. Again, the case that we have had in the US against the Department of Justice is a case which I think is going to lead to more developments, more thinking, and probably a more balanced approach in the way law enforcement agencies can compel companies to provide data. The situation needs to evolve. And we can go into the case, we can discuss it, but I think things are evolving on that front as well.
I think I also saw a hand raised in the audience too. Actually, do we have any roaming mics that they could get to?
Hello. Thank you very much. My name is Guideng, and I'm a PhD student at the University of Minnesota. I would just like to have your opinion regarding what about government-initiated cyber attacks to be brought to be more generic in a term. So, what about government-initiated cyber attacks, but that was not conducted through the main government agencies? So for this relates to the point, because for instance in the US we have the Freedom of Information Act that allows you to approach respective entities to get information, but related to your point, sir, also is that what we are viewing is obviously a very small self-selected sample, which means that if we can only observe so let's say for those incidents that we can observe regarding government attacks, there is clearly a point that they can say, there is a narrative, a legitimate narrative that they can have. They can justify their actions. What about those that were initiated by government but not conducted through those entities, right? So obviously it could be for several reasons, and so I wanted to get a sense of, do we think, so now we do not even have an idea of, is it a bigger proportion than what we can observe right now, or much smaller, or is it not a concern? So I wonder if you have any response to that. Thank you.
So in the paper we published last year, we tackle this by saying that even if it's not conducted, if an operation is not conducted by the government itself, any entity at the direction of a government, and we use a lot of different words and framings and to get at contractors and et cetera, they need to be subject to the same requirements. You cannot end run around protections just by contracting out these operations. I had mentioned the framework that was proposed in Italy. They actually prohibit the use of contractors to conduct hacking operations. It has to be conducted through government employees themselves if they're going to do it, which is a approach. It is probably the most solid approach because it means that there is some sort of control over the data and responsiveness to laws like open government laws. But I don't think that they should be able to end run around. And we're seeing, and we saw when Hacking Team got hacked, we saw that there are a lot of governments all over the world that are using entities like Hacking Team to conduct or to target these operations. And that meant that they were very secretive, they were very off the radar. In a lot of countries we see that they are They are non-state actors acting at the direction of the state, perhaps not provably, but ostensibly provably, and that they should not be able to get around those requirements either. It is much more difficult to do that. So I will say that I'm applying this very high standard, and then I'm caveating by saying, in practice, it is hard to ensure that those requirements are met, which means that a lot of safeguards, even if implemented, are going to be not effectuated because people will try to find these ways around them.
Is there anybody else in the panel who would like to respond to this?
It's not really a response. I fully agree with all the points that you are making. That's one of the reasons why in this proposal for a convention we have also a private part where the ICT companies come together and say, commit not to assist governments in conducting cyber attacks, number one, and second, that's also where I think an organization, which would be an attribution organization, you know, an organization which has the manpower and technical resources to identify the origin of the attack is something which would be helpful. It's probably one of the most difficult things to do, one of the most severe challenges that is being faced in the cybersecurity world these days, which is to go back to the authors of the attack. That's why we think that the setting up of an attribution organization that would combine both private and public sector resources would be a positive development.
I think there's time for one more question from the audience, if there are any left. Hans, go ahead.
It's a quick sort of reminder that I think that with sort of our generalized societal horniness for more data always, that as a company, you can't lose what you don't have, and you can't give something to government that you don't have. So I think we shouldn't forget sort of this privacy by design aspects, that if you design your services in such a way that you don't know stuff about your customers, the things that you don't need to know and that you can't know. For me, that was one of the lessons of the Apple FBI case, that Apple really just couldn't give this stuff and needed to be forced to do things that they didn't want to do before they would be able to do it. And that is, I think, one of the sort of important constraints that the private sector could help us deliver, in a sense.
Anybody on the panel like to react to that? Was there, then I guess we have time for another question. Probably Mike, thank you.
I'll do.
Okay. It was touching on what you were just saying, Amy, around the role of the private sector and government contracting out to the private sector. And I wondered if you could talk a little bit to the trade in vulnerabilities and exploits and how, you know, that's really fostering the existence of these vulnerabilities and weaknesses which make the internet as a whole weaker, but, you know, it's a completely unregulated market, but one where regulation, I'm not really sure how that would work or whether we would necessarily want governments to regulate that, seeing as they're the ones who are buying all these vulnerabilities and stockpiling them themselves. So, yeah.
One of the things that technologist Matt Blaze is very fond of saying, and that I am very fond of repeating in many of the panels that I partake on because he is sometimes more eloquent than I am, is that technologists are bad at their jobs. Which means that no product, technology product, really ships without a vulnerability in it. And oftentimes several, which need to be patched or can be, if not patched, taken advantage of. Because government hacking and the great amount of information that can be accessed through government hacking operations is so valuable, it means that those vulnerabilities become highly valuable, and specifically zero-day vulnerabilities, which Ton talked about, which can the company doesn't know about and can be capitalized on immediately. That desire to have access to those have mean that governments have started paying top dollar to be able to gain them. In the United States specifically, this has become a huge problem. We debated it for a very long time, and they really didn't care that we were talking about it until about 2013, I believe. No, 2014, when it finally reached fever pitch, and the White House Office of Science and Technology Policy and their cybersecurity coordinator, Michael Daniel, released a statement saying that they were going to, quote unquote, reinvigorate their vulnerabilities equities process, or VEP, because in DC we like acronyms. And it meant that there's this longstanding process that they weren't using, where whenever they gained or discovered a vulnerability, they were supposed to bring everybody to the table, meaning like the Department of Commerce, the National Security Agency, the FBI, get them all into a room and say, what is the value of this vulnerability? What is the risk if we do not disclose it, that somebody else will find it and a lot of people will have their information compromised? What is its value to national security? What is our ability to use it in specific operations? And at the end of that conversation, they are either supposed to disclose it or not disclose it, with the preference for disclosing it. We don't know how that is really being implemented. There have been some numbers thrown about that they are now disclosing large percentages of the vulnerabilities that they get in. But we also know from the Apple FBI case that they have found end runs around this process. Because in that case, rather than either discovering or gaining access to a vulnerability, they basically got a black box. And they were able to plug that black box into the iPhone and hack the iPhone. But they never had access to the vulnerability that was used inside that black box. So they didn't have to submit that vulnerability to go through the process. And nobody knows what that vulnerability was, which means anybody with that version of iPhone probably still can be hacked using the same vulnerability. And since iPhones are very, very ubiquitous in many parts of the world, that means a lot and a lot of people are vulnerable. We believe that this makes everybody insecure. The fact that governments decide that hacking is something they need to engage in, and that because of that they need to store vulnerabilities instead of disclosing them, makes massive numbers of people insecure, which is one of the reasons that this type of activity is so dangerous, which is one of the reasons that we think it really needs to be well regulated and have a lot of safeguards. Because otherwise, if it's able to be conducted openly and freely and without those safeguards, the value of those vulnerabilities will continue to go up. The ability of people to use their devices securely is going to continue to go down. And many people on this panel have talked about the extreme number of devices on the market right now. And in one of the sessions yesterday, I sat there and watched a internet-connected sex toy be hacked. And that is not something that I want governments to be able to hack into for individuals. And that's the road that we are going down.
Yeah, I would like to add to that, that obviously, I mean, these unknown vulnerabilities, these 0 days are obviously, we've talked about it, they're very, very important. But we also need to remind ourselves that there are also a lot of unpatched devices out there which could be patched, but companies either don't do it or they went bankrupt. There are a lot of insecure devices, and they're not unknown vulnerabilities per se. I think we should also go towards a system where we can actually hold companies accountable for not patching or updating their devices, because for law enforcement, it's far easier and cheaper to hack into unpatched devices because people are either too lazy to install an update, or because the company thinks, well, it's not in my best interest to update this device.
And on that note, I think we've covered a lot of the economic, legal, ethical, and technical levers in this debate that could be used to improve the situation. I think we've actually made some great headway in that sense. And I hope you will join me all in thanking the panel for this excellent discussion.